Good evening, Anshin sir, and thank you very much for accepting my invitation for this interaction. Thank you so much, sir.
Good evening, Purvesh, and good that you are taking such interviews, and all of us are doing good time pass actually. So I have been following your interviews. You are asking lot of questions, etc., and it's a good idea, not a bad idea at all.
Thank you, sir.
To start this series or whatever, however you term it as.
Right, sir. We thought that at least life of the seniors could actually motivate the juniors. So that's the intention of this interaction, sir. Thank you.
But that senior bracket is still very different. I mean, the junior seniors. So what you're talking, those inspiration seniors are very different, you know. But, we are still junior and seniors.
No, but sir, having designation at this age, it is in itself an achievement. So even we need to get motivated to have your path. And if we could achieve that, it would be great for us as well. Thank you.
No, thanks a lot. Tell me.
Was it your always motivation, I mean, your goal to join this profession, or you had some other career options available?
No, I don't think so. I had any career option available. I was not a very ambitious person in the sense that I was just above average student. Mm-hmm. And I never had that I am going to wanted to become a doctor or an engineer or something, because I was very bad in maths. Mm-hmm. I was okay in science, so maths was always a problem. Mm-hmm. So not that I thought much, very honestly. People in my class, my colleagues, my friends, lot of them were very ambitious, because I have done my schooling from Junagadh. So there were people at that time going to Baroda to study further. They used to go to Rosary School in Baroda or St. Mary's School in Rajkot after 10th, because Junagadh did not have English medium after 10th standard. But very honestly, I had not given it a thought, nor was I pushed that much by my parents. I was an easygoing student comparatively, and there was no pressure from the family. So it was like a flow, you know. My father is a lawyer. My grandfather was a lawyer. My grandfather then left advocacy and he was IES at that time, and he retired as collector Amreli in Gujarat. So not much I thought for. I went for a little comfortable, cool and a relaxed line, according to me at that time, was a lawyer's line.
Right.
That is how probably I chose.
So sir.
And it was like theory of Purvesh, it was like theory of elimination. Mm-hmm. That you are not good in maths, so science was cut out. I was not at all good in chemistry, so that's why the science was cut out. Commerce, accounts was the issue, arithmetic, so I was bad. So then arts was the only line left at that time, so I did my BA.
Right, sir. So what will define Anshin sir as a child?
As a child, I was an introvert child. Mm-hmm. I was a good boy in class. Mm-hmm. My two very good friends were pretty notorious, but I used to be maintain pin drop silence, and I was a very soft person when I was a child, and nothing adventurous. I used to be I never stood first rank, but I was in the third, fourth, or fifth, ranks were the issue at that time. So no, but I had a very relaxed childhood in the sense that nothing notorious in school.
Right.
Yeah.
So which college have you graduated your law from?
I did my law from Nav Gujarat College, Ahmedabad. Mm-hmm. What happened was I did my schooling in Junagadh till 9th standard in Carmel Convent School, which was the only English medium school at that point of time, which was a very good school. Mm-hmm. In fact, very good school. The teachers were missionaries. There were some Roman teachers over there. So it was a very good school. But from 10th, I shifted to Mumbai. I was staying at my maternal uncle's house. Mm-hmm. With my sisters. And I did my 10th in St. Anne's School in Bandra. Mm-hmm. Then I did my college in Mumbai, Mithibai College of Arts. I did my arts in economics in Mithibai. I took my major as economics. And then I did my law from Nav Gujarat College, Ahmedabad, because after I finished college in Mumbai, then the charm and glamour of Mumbai took over, and I didn't want to come back to Gujarat. My father said, you can't afford anything in Mumbai, so better start. Ultimately, you want to become a lawyer, so you come back to Junagadh. So I went back to Junagadh. I did not like to go back at all at that point of time, but I did go. And then I joined Nav Gujarat College at Ahmedabad, Ashram Road.
Right. Sir, were you regular in your legal studies?
No, not at all. Not at all. Not regular at all. I don't remember very honestly attending any lecture. So if anyone comes to know today, they will throw me out as a lawyer also probably. But no, I was not at all regular. In fact, let me tell you this openly that I took admission over here. I went to Junagadh and I used to only come to give exams. I did all my studies from Jhabwala in Junagadh and I hardly attended college. No, not at all. So today's students are far, far superior, far, far meticulous, who are actually, and the colleges have also become strict now in attendance.
True.
So that time it was not like that. So no, not at all regular.
Sir, what do you think? Whether your education system was better or the present one? Where the colleges?
No, I would say, I would say present is much better. There's no doubt about it. But I also feel that 5-year education system for a person who wants to practice is not very convenient, because then you don't get time to practice, go to courts. You being a full time from morning to mid afternoon, like all 5-year courses are morning to mid afternoon, and there's a lot of projects and a lot of works. It does help. I know that my son is now in the 3rd year, so I know that it does help. I'm not saying it does not help, but a practical knowledge to go to court is only during internship, and that I feel is very short period to do something, learn something, or just while away time in court, because that is the time when first 3 years I had done the 3-year course, because that time only 3-year course was there. But that 3-year course, actually I personally feel that 3-year course is a very good course, because it is like part time. It is over by 10-11 o'clock in the morning if you are attending college. Not a person like me would never not attend it. But if you are attending college, then you can actually join someone's office. Just sit over there. See how a lawyer talks to a client, how they deal with the client, how do they assess the merits of the case, how do they tell the client that to litigate, not to litigate, what fees to charge, how to charge, how to appease a judge, how to argue before a judge, how to convince a judge, how to take care, manners, etc. That no college can teach, I feel. Moot courts and all, I don't think so. They are substitute to actual practical knowledge, and that is only pure observation. In court, that your observation will be different, my observation will be different. It makes a difference from person to person. So I feel that the timing and the load of 5 years is much more. That I would not agree that this much is required. And there are many subjects in these 5-year courses which are not required, I feel. Pollution, etc. You can have a very elementary subject as pollution, but you can't have papers. And there's so many subjects in law. You are anyhow going to practice. So we have not learnt all subjects. You get a bare act and then you start processing a matter. So I feel that study-wise it is good. Study-wise it is good. They are meticulous. They are exposed to much more than what we were in 3-year course or at that time. But only the timing and the load of work should reduce. That's what I think.
Right, sir. Sir, does the intensive study on theories, theoretical aspect of law, would not help the student as advised by you to have more practical experience?
No, I agree. Theory does help. I'm not saying no at all. Like putting up legal maxims at the right place or understanding legal maxims. For instance, take my case, that a person like me was not regular at all. I had to buy Broom's legal maxim to understand what is res ipsa loquitur, in the sense, except for the studies part of it, where it used to come. The stare decisis, res integra, all these things were alien to me, because the exposure in 3-year course is not that much. So theory, I agree. Theory, there is no doubt about it, that theory is 100 times better than what we have studied. But if you want to practice, I feel you must give equal marks to practical knowledge. And a child must attend office of a lawyer and also the court. At court he may attend for 1-2 hours, it's all right. But office of a lawyer is more material. That is the maternity house of litigation in a trial court. So I feel that is very, very important, practical also.
Right, sir. So these days the students are usually get absorbed by law firms or the corporate sectors more. And the students who are bright are usually get absorbed by them, and they prefer to go for that sector rather than to come into litigation. And thereby we lose yes. a bright student in who does not actually join the litigation. So what is yes. your advice to such students who, if at all, they would like to join litigation? What is your advice to them?
See, Purush, honestly, tell you, I did not have this much of knowledge about this 5 year, how it works, etc. Till my son gave CLAT, and he's in JNU. So till he came in, I had no idea that how this whole thing works, because he would not be interested that how the people do, we are not interested. But now that I know, I feel that 5 year course people opt for, or there's a craze to go in national or universities, mainly NLUs, is because of placement. If a student has no legal background, if he's coming from a business family, having a shop or a business, or he's from a, he's a doctor's daughter or a son, he's a daughter or an engineer or some, in the sense, not a legal background, then people opt for, and you are doing very well, you are brilliant, then people opt for placements and go for NLUs. There's a scramble for NLUs for the reason that the pay packet is very good. So the security is huge. For a non-lawyer family, the security is massive. So, and the pay packets are very attractive. And you and me both know, probably you also know and I know, that first 5, 10, 15 years, you don't earn anything in this profession. It is a struggle and collection of work and a lot of learning, lot of people climbing your shoulders, crushing your shoulders. So these are things which people from a, not from a legal background are not used to seeing. You are used to seeing, Purvish. I'm used to seeing this, how you struggle, and you can go ahead if you struggle. But a person having no lawyer in the family, it's very difficult. And secondly, work structure, work time, that today you can give in 12 to 14 hours in your office. You know that it's going to pay back. I can do it. But that person, or in the family of a businessman, they will feel that no, this much you put in so many hours and you don't get any money. Your senior takes the fees. So I think that is a big consideration for placements and for youth pay packets which a person gets. And there is a ready-made litigation available with good exposure on table.
Right. Sir, when have you started going to courts?
I started going from the first year, because I did not attend college well. So I joined my father's office in Junagadh. My father is basically an advocate mainly on the civil side. So I joined his office, and my father's juniors, I used to go along with them on a two-wheeler. And went to Junagadh court every day, not for the whole day, but about 1.5-2 hours a day. And they used to make me write adjournment applications, what is process fees. And actually, let me share with you, I was registered as a clerk in Junagadh court. Mm-hmm. My father got me registered as a clerk in the Junagadh court for the purpose that if you're a clerk, you can go and see the file. You can get exhibit numbers done. You can arrange the file in the registry. So I was given a clerkship in the office. District judge was Justice who's Mr. Tolia. You know Harshit's father, Shri Shirish Bhai Tolia. He was the district judge Junagadh that time. So he had given, through him I was a clerk. And that is how I went to court from day one. From day one I went. When I was in the first year.
Sir, with whom did you start your practice after graduating?
When I was in the third year, the second half, the sixth semester, at that point of time, I was brought to Ahmedabad by my father, and I did not like Ahmedabad at all, because then that Mumbai thing was there in my mind. And then Junagadh had taken over, because Junagadh, I had a bike, I had friends, and I was living a relaxed lifestyle completely. So third year, sixth semester, I was brought by my father over here. He introduced me to Sri Nirupam Bhai Nanavati, and he is my father's very dear friend. So I joined his office from the third year itself for a period of about 5.5 years.
Right, sir.
So I joined Sri Nirupam Nanavati.
Right. So what are the most striking quality of Nirupam Bhai that you carry along with you?
Oh, there are qualities and qualities. I can share with you, he is a man of tremendous wit, first of all. So, the way he used to deal with clients is very different. Only if you attend office, you'll realize that how he dealt with clients. And he was extremely meticulous. he used to write postcards himself, even at that time, on a printed postcard after the matter was over, that notice is issued, it is stays granted, it is admitted, whatever. He used to write five-liner postcards every day. He used to maintain the office register himself for a long period of time. He used to really handle clients very well. And the best quality was in court. I think you know it, but let me share it because people may not know in the court was. He taught me, or I learned from him, the biggest was when not to speak. What to speak and how much to speak. How much to argue, in short. That how much do you argue? And when you go on an offensive, and the honorable judge feels that you are on offensive and he starts going on offensive, how to withdraw, how to go back, how to crack a small, mention some anecdote and crack a small joke and try to bring the learned judge back to your stride. So, lot many things. But you cannot imbibe Sri Nanamati. Hero Bombay, he is... he's a king in his own style. So no one can actually, but you learn a lot. There's no doubt about it. Court manners, how do you argue? Lot of things to do. I am really obliged to my father. I learned a lot of things from my father in Junagadh court. How do you behave in court? How do you talk, convey things in court? How do you lead evidence? I used to follow up. I used to prepare questionnaire, cross-examination sheet, etc. So I first, my father, Harish Bhai Desai, was a guru. I learned a lot of things because I'll tell you, two people in civil courts, even today, if I'm not mistaken, in Junagadh, etc., there is no stenography system. So the juniors are made to write memo of appeal, plain, the senior dictates and the junior writes. So from drawing a margin on a paper, that how do you keep margin when my father used to make me write 2-3 hours at that time in Gujarati. Because their pleadings were in Gujarati, except district court appeal memos were in English. So, in English and Gujarati, he used to make me write 20-30 pages in the evening, 20-30 pages in the morning because of drafting. So, I learned a lot of procedure, that what is verification in Gujarati, what is called a ikrar, then how a plaint is drafted. Of course, I didn't learn that much that time, but I understood that how ABC of litigation starts, how a matter is to be cultivated, what law will apply. So my father, I learned a lot of things. As far as arguments are concerned, I never practiced in civil court there in the initial stage. So I learned a lot of things from Nirupambai in court. I started from High Court in 1994, midnight, late 1994 in August, on August 5th. So I learned a lot of things from him in High Court.
Sir, when did you have become independent?
I became independent in the year of 1999, around June 1999, after about 5.5 years with Sri Nirupambai.
How difficult was it for you to become independent out from the sheltered office of Nirupambai?
No, I will fairly tell you that it was not very difficult because I used to get comparatively good work. Good work is you could manage your expenses, and I was married in 97. So till 97, it was all enjoyment, going for a movie in drive-in cinema, moving around and we having some snack in the evening. So it was maintenance part, but I had small matters. Caveat was a big litigation. Earning in caveat applications was the best. That you charge 1,000, 2,000 rupees in a caveat application and your fuel is taken care of. So, not very tough. Let me tell you, it was not very tough. But yes, my flat where I'm staying right now, my third bedroom was my office that day. So, there was no money to buy office. So, that was my office for about 6 years after I left. But it was not very difficult. Yes. During 99, I became an independent. In 2001, unfortunate, that earthquake happened on 26 January. So that had an effect on everyone, probably in Gujarat. And the litigation, the courts stopped working for a long time. The clients did not turn up. So that 2001 to 2002-03 was a gray area somewhere. But it was uniform. But I didn't find it very difficult, to be very honest. God was great and I could manage.
Yes. So, when was your first independent appearance before court, and were you nervous while appearing?
As I told you, I had never stood on a stage in my life. I'd never caught a mic in my hand. I did catch mic in my hand when I was in the 7th or the 8th standard to sing a song with two of my friends, and we fumbled halfway. That was the only incident I stood there. So I had huge fear of standing up before anyone and saying something. I appeared on the first day in a second appeal of partition before Honorable Justice K.R. Vyas. And you will be glad to know my opponent was now retired Honorable Ms. Justice R.M. Doshit. She was for the other side, and I was for the caveator, and she was for the appellant. And it was second appeal on 5th of August 1994, on the very first date I argued. But then, as I stood up, I had written down everything from my lords to what to say, which I lost track half the way after 7-8 lines, because then I understood that I have to face only one person. Everyone is behind me or on my side. So then that fear slowly evaporated, and I was very well prepared on facts. My father had taught me a lot of things. My colleagues in my office with Mr. Nanavati, Honorable Justice Chaya was in office of Mr. Indy Nanavati. So he had helped me out a lot to know how to prepare, what to say. So I was cushioned. There were people sitting, my friends were sitting. But then it was not very difficult. Yes, there was an order passed against me. In the first matter, I lost. So, but yes, I appeared on the very first date in a second appeal. Probably that second appeal is, you'll be shocked to know that it is still pending.
Right, sir. Sir, any specific matter that you can recollect which has changed your attitude in the legal profession?
Yes. So, my, I can say there was one Karupa Avodidra called PSI who was transferred, and it was a transfer matter which I refused to take on the ground that transfer matters, courts were not interfering, and Justice Doshit was a judge at that point of time taking up service matters. So my father said, you take a vow, you are not at a stage of declining matters, you take it. You have to survive in this profession, you don't select, you don't become a judge. My father had sent me the matter. So I said, but I'm nervous, I can't, there is no point. It was an administrative transfer. So then I started working on it. I refused to take the matter. So the client came, the PSI, and told me that I'll give you an X amount of fees, which was double than what we used to be the normal small for a person like me fees after 7-8 years of practice. So that tempted me a lot. I prepared that matter and then started looking at law, which we don't do now, that juniors are very well equipped today. They look at law, they look at the provision and then draft. I did it the other way around, and it was before Justice Doshit, and I raised an issue of it is a penal transfer, no hearing is granted. And on inquiries with client, there was a communication which he gave that so-and-so of the DSP had written a complaint. So on that ground, I built up the matter and I got an order of admission and the injunction was granted. It was the first boost I got in a matter which I thought was impossible for a notice to be issued in a court like Justice Doshit. She was very good in service laws and a very strict disciplinarian judge. But then I got an order in that, was one of the matters. Then there was another land matter before Justice Balia. You know, the late Justice Balia was also a brilliant judge. Yeah. And he used to take up no nonsense. You have to be on the point, crisp arguments. And if you go a little bit haywire, he'll throw you out. Or he will at least, there will be an ambush in court. So there was a land matter which was a 50-50 matter. And in which I got a good order. What was a big land matter actually. Not fee-wise, but the structure of the matter was pretty big and the client had reposed a lot of faith. And one interesting matter I must tell you before this, Balia, when you're asking me this. Yes. There was a student in St. Xavier's School in Jamnagar.
Yes.
He was of an ex-community. Mm. And there was an altercation with the principal. He was a father. And the boy in the 9th standard slapped the father. The principal.
Yes.
So he was restricted from school. Mm. So that matter came to me through someone from Jamnagar. I said, you have slapped the principal of the school. I cannot think in my school of standing next to the principal. The boy had slapped the father, said, you can't restricate. And the lawyer who had come was also very well equipped. He said, principles of natural justice are violated, etc., etc. And there also he said, no, you, we have to file. So I filed a petition straight. It was a minority institution, St. Xavier's. It is a minority institution. And the matter was to come before this tribunal. So I was shivering. Very honestly, I was extremely nervous that what will be the reaction of the court where you are saying that your petitioner has slapped the principal of the school. So then you raise all grounds that no, this has not happened. This is wrong. You should have heard me. You cannot rusticate. I am a young child. And a petition was filed. So Justice Balia, first of all, jumped that what are you, whom are you appealing for? Do you realize you are a student? Not only teacher, he's the principal and you slap him in a mass PT physical training. So this was an incident which happened and a notice was issued by the court on the ground that no hearing is given, no inquiry is conducted, that this is a even though moral turpitude, how else do you comment that you have assaulted a principal, your career will be over. On that ground only notice was issued. The learned Mr. Kamal Trivedi, who is now the learned AG of Gujarat, appeared for St. Xavier's and raised all the issues only on the ground and gave me a very tough time. Mr. Trivedi, he always gives a tough time, so he gave a very tough time. And but on the ground of breach of principles of natural justice, the order was stayed. He was permitted to attend school. Ultimately, he finished his 10th standard and he came out and the petition became infructuous. So this was one point which this was one such matter at that time. Then later in point of time, one matter which I did and where I got a lot of exposure, which I must share with you, was a land acquisition matter where a division bench a notification in Surat in land acquisition proceedings, notification about 20 to 23 properties was published. And one of the properties, someone challenged before the High Court. The division bench upheld the notification by saying that no urgency clause for public purpose. So sewerage line was to be laid down. So, and the other portion came to me. And at that point of time, I had engaged Mr. Meer Thakur, a senior advocate. So there was a first hearing took place and the petition was admitted and stay was granted. In that, after that, the bench changed and after the pleadings were over, the petition was thrown, petition was admitted, but the relief was refused on the ground that I have suppressed that earlier notification. One other portion was challenged and where you have lost some time back, which was of course not in my knowledge because that was some other parts of the land, but the court came down heavily upon me and rejected the petition. And that time Mr. Thakur was busy in UK for some arbitration matters, so could not attend and everything came upon us. Ultimately, we took that interim order to the Honorable Supreme Court. And I appeared before the Supreme Court and it was a bench of Justice Singhvi and Justice Mukhopadhyay as a tenor. And they came down heavily upon me that you have suppressed and you have the courage before Supreme Court. And I was thrashed in Supreme Court initially and the other side was unclear. But ultimately, the court found that no, there was a relief which was granted. So you, this is a separate parcel of land. So either you will continue the relief or we will send it back for reconsideration. Yes. So it went back. So that was a huge success. It came back. It came back before the same bench. Mm-hmm. The bench heard it for about 11 days in the second session and referred it to a larger bench. The larger bench consisting of Honorable Justice Bhattacharya, Chief Justice, as it then was, Justice Paldiwala, and Honorable Justice Upadhyay. And they heard it for about 2 weeks and then set aside the notification in my favor. The matter again was carried by State of Gujarat and the Surat Municipal Corporation before Supreme Court. We engaged Mr. Salve initially and Mr. Harin Rawal initially. And then the matter was, but the matter was admitted. The status quo was granted against me. Then it went on for some time and clients could not afford further. The length of litigation was longish. So then I started appearing and the matter went on for about 4 years in Supreme Court before several benches. And ultimately, it's reported that when the matter was rejected and order was passed that to give some other land, yes, acquisition was upheld, but some other clear title, marketable land was ordered to be given, was, according to me, was a big success for me because that, according to me, was a tough matter to deal with and that too before the Honorable Supreme Court. So that was a huge matter as far as I was concerned. For the confidence which I could derive from that litigation.
Right, sir. Sir, whom do you consider to be your idol or mentor other than Nirupam Bhai, of course, and your father?
Yes, there are Purush, I would share that. Of course, my father and Nirupam Bhai share a special place in my bringing up as a lawyer. Then I learned a lot of things from Mr. Mir Joshi. Mr. Mir Joshi, I did not know Mr. Mir Joshi at all. But in one case before Honorable Justice Pooja, I was arguing and there was some rough arguments in the court. So Mr. Mir Joshi called me in the evening to office and he said, "You can't behave like with a judge like this. You were doing well. Why did you behave so badly before the Honorable Court?" And then he started referring some cases to me for preparing, etc. So I learned a lot from Mr. Mir Joshi. For a few years, I did a lot of work for him. Then I learned a lot from Mr. Arin Rawal because he became ASG in Gujarat.
Yeah.
And I was also taken in 2007. So from him, I learned a lot. And of course, from Honorable Justice Chaya, who is an Honorable Judge now, because I was in the office for 3 to 3.5 years we shared together. So I learned a lot of drafting because he used to do a lot of drafting for Nirupam Bhai. So I learned a lot from him also. Then in High Court, I learned a lot from Mr. Tushar Mehta also. He was doing a lot of contested matters at that point of time. And observing now retired Honorable Justice Jayant Patel, they were all real fighters. So from I can say that my father, Nirupam Bhai, Mihir Bhai Joshi, Arin Bhai Rawal, and Honorable Justice Chaya, as he then was a lawyer, Tushar Bhai Mehta, from few of them, I picked up a lot of things. And they were all real good lawyers. And I have learned a lot in drafting. How do you convince a court? How do you put up your case? Court manners from all of these. So all of them have influenced a lot.
So who are the people that you would attribute your success to? It could be your client, seniors, juniors, family members, whomsoever you want to.
No, I would attribute my success a lot to unconditional support of my parents. My parents have never asked me a question. My mother, my father, they've never asked me a question. Never have they asked me how much do I earn. Of course, they've never taken anything from me at any point of time. So, huge support from my mother and my father. My family. Of course, all the seniors whom I said, I must not miss Nirupam Bhai, etc. That, yes, I owe a lot to him and others. And of course, after marriage, my wife, in her family, there is no one who was a lawyer. For her after marriage to understand that I leave home. I was with Nirupam Bhai at that time at around 8:30 and I come home at around 10:30. So it was, she was from a family of people who were all employed. So she had no idea that the work structure is such that you are out of the house from morning to evening, including Sunday, you are out in half the day or more at times. So unconditional support from my wife also. She's always been a great support till date. Never asked me questions, never asked me that, no, you're not giving me enough time. No movies, no restaurants, no family time, no socializing time, no such questions are asked. And they were asked initially, but they were taken care of.
So what do you expect from advocate who brief you?
Purveshi, I am 3-year-old as a designated advocate. I used to get a few matters before that. I'm not saying no. But for an advocate to brief me, I don't keep a lot of expectations, to be very frank. Because I'm a counsel of where they've come to see to it that something, where they cannot see something, I have to see and repair, or I have to put it across that way. So I don't expect a lot from them. But I ask them that if you have time, then please show me one rough draft. If you have time. So I am not shy to modify the draft, especially the prayers, the cause title, and on facts. So one thing I'm particular, which I try and tell people who come to brief me, is that be very clear on facts. Don't hush up or hurry up in a matter. If required, yes, there is sometimes it is overnight. So then you can't help it. Then you move amendments, which I also don't like in courts would today not like. But yes, I would like the advocate to be clear on facts. Rest, I don't pressurize them because they are young friends. And I don't expect a lot of things, very honestly, from them. So Yes, facts. I feel that, and I tell them that I am not shy to call clients. If you are comfortable, call him. I can ask. If you are not comfortable asking, because there are some uncomfortable questions which the lawyers don't ask, with the fear that the client might take back the papers. So I tell them that no, you convince him, and if you can't convince, if you have no problem, I have no problem. I am ready to give more time. So I don't expect much except that on clarity on facts. That's all.
That's it. Sir, have you ever had an instance where you thought that there was no merit in the brief? And how do you deal with such situation?
Yes, as I told you, that first service matter of that PSI I had was an issue, was one such matter. But my father always used to tell me, and he still tells me, that you don't become a judge. You try your effort. You are not to decide. You are not sitting on the other side. You are sitting standing on this side. So right. Make an effort. Don't just, you know, but yes. With there is improvisation with passage of time. Now all of us do that, and even I do that. That you must tell that the limitations of the matter are known now. Yeah, and I think, Purvish, that litigants also partly know that what is the level of interference. Like in before the Honorable Supreme Court, we all know that the level of interference is very less. Like in high courts also, before some honorable courts, it is very difficult to get an order. Before some honorable courts, it is still you don't get an injunction. So yes, the limitations we do point out now, that these are the limitations that but yes, there are some matters which you feel before on a difficult court, that this, it will be difficult that this court it does not agree at initial stage to grant an order. But then you know, if there is a merit in the matter, you insist that no, this is a good case, don't worry, we'll do, somewhere you get a relief. That is also the level of confidence you draw at times. You may be wrong. You may be proved wrong at a point of time. But yes, that does happen. But limitations of an issue before you, you do, at least I do convey at times. And clients do, lawyers and clients do take back papers at times.
Right. So what methodology do you adopt to prepare matters by yourself?
By myself, I try and prepare dates and events. My colleagues with me have now done that. They do a great job with me now, so they also prepare. I tell the advocate also to prepare if they want to prepare, if they have time, who comes to brief me, or at least I prepare. So I start from the impugned order. If it's not the impugned order, then the prayer and the bare act. What does the section say? What? Because you get matters at the last moment and the client meeting is not there, to which we are used to initial point of time before designation. So that is literally uncomfortable for me today also, that I have not had access with the client. That cross-examination of client part, I was very interested to ask questions which are uncomfortable to get an answer for me to answer in the court. So I prepare it if possible. Chronology is a must if the volume is big. And one thing, yes, I'm sorry, I missed it. You said that what do you expect? If it's from the original side, I never do a matter unless and until I get the full paper book. You must have, if it's from the suit proceedings, you must have the file of it's a writ. Then the appellate court's papers, etc. Till written arguments. I insist exhibit-wise file of the trial court. Yes, I insist this from the lawyer. And if not there, 99% I don't stand up without looking at the whole file, which should be there with the lawyer. So that is, I look at the original file, mark my relevant against and in favor both documents and orders, and try and prepare chronology, handwritten chronology. I prepare handwritten chronology for myself, short notes. That is all.
Sir, what are your hobbies and how do you pursue same along with your busy professional career?
Hobbies, I used to play a lot of badminton. I used to take part in my place in Junagadh. Has one wall adjoining is our gymkhana, that is the club. Junagadh has one club. So I played tournaments over there. I was a runner-up in district level at a point of time in school for badminton. And I continue playing badminton in Ahmedabad. I'm a member in Karnavati clubs. I continue playing badminton for a lot many years in the morning tournament. But then I continue playing a lot of badminton. And then with passage of time, I go to exercise. But badminton, I stop because I don't get time. I used to go very early in the morning. Now everyone comes very late in the morning. And then you don't get time in this profession. So badminton, I don't play a lot now. But badminton is my hobby. One. Second is sketching. I do a lot of pencil sketching.
Mm-hmm.
I started because of my mother. She persuaded me to copy R.K. Lakshman's caricatures in the Times of India.
Right.
When I was a child in school. And when R.K. Lakshman got a Magsaysay Award at that time, she convinced me that you draw a picture of R.K. Lakshman with the common man and send it across. I sent it across, and after 3 months, I got a photograph with a letter on my drawing, which I framed and kept it as it is. And then I started to do a lot of drawings. So I have done a lot of sketching, which also in the recent past I have not done. But these are the two hobbies, right? Caricatures and badminton.
Sir, how have you utilized your time during this lockdown period?
Lockdown, I am living in a flat, residing in a flat. My converted hobby is also gardening. So I've got a lot of pots in my three balconies. So I take care in the morning. I do something alternative, gardening, watering the plants, because there is no staff coming now. So that is one thing in the morning. Then second thing I started, I am not a very good reader of novels or books, but I have collected some self-help books which I refer to at times. So Why I am a Hindu by Shashi Tharoor, I am reading this now. Mahabharata Jaya by Devdutt Patnaik I am referring to. And I've got Constituent Assembly Debates, 4 volumes from Lok Sabha I had purchased, which I had just kept it in the bookshelf. So now I have started to slowly read that. So that is one portion. Then I have started to connect with a lot of my school friends. Not many, but few of my school friends, college friends who are staying abroad in US, etc. So I give a 2-3 calls to my old clients, to my lawyer friends. So that is how we connect on video call in the morning for some time. Afternoon, I used to sleep, but now we have stopped sleeping because it became my habit that you start yawning in court. So I read a little bit, and evening I watch one serial. Night again I watch another episode on Netflix or something. I like thriller series, so I lot more series. That's how I'm whiling away time now.
Right. Sir, any message that you would like to give to the legal fraternity as a whole to remain positive during this lockdown period?
No, it is difficult to remain positive. It is like an hanging sword that you just can't come out. If you come out, there's a scare that you touch something, and it is impossible to manage not to touch anything, to go anything. So, but positive is that indulge yourself in something what you like, what you're saying, that you like. What you are doing is an excellent work just now. So this is a huge thing. You prepare questions, you prepare everything, edit, or however you must be doing it. So it's a something like this is positive. Or people who are reading books, who are fond of reading or writing. There are many whom I know are fond of writing poems or phrases or reading. So that is the only way you can keep positive. And connectivity has become a big thing now within the family. People have connected very, very well. The biggest problem is mobile phone. That if you open WhatsApp, then that WhatsApp university takes your 1-1.5 hour time whenever you open it. So, and there are bad news. So I would request that don't watch news. I don't watch news. So don't watch news at all. Except for the election result, don't watch news. That is the time when lawyers should get involved. That elections are there, who's coming, who's going, whatever is there. But positive is don't watch news is the first thing. Second thing, connect with your family, your friends, your children, your parents. That is another thing. You can't do anything. You are in confinement. Yes. Not solitary confinement, but in confinement.
Right, sir.
That's all.
Sir, what changes do you foresee in the legal profession post-lockdown?
Purvish, very honestly, I don't foresee a lot of changes.
Mm-hmm.
I don't foresee a lot of changes. Once we are back in tune, people get used to it, or how they are saying that there is something like herd immunity. So I am not able to understand that concept, that how it will work. But however they are saying, but I don't think that there will be a lot of changes. Because personally, I feel that video conferencing does not appeal a lot to me. I am doing some matters because it is like, with all due respect to everybody, it is like compliance or a formality being completed.
Right.
Our profession, if we both are opposing each other, we see each other's body language.
Right.
Like how we call demeanor of a witness. So we see our body language. We see the honorable judge's expressions. He or she, the honorable judge, looks at us. So that is not possible in video conferencing. So video conferencing for immediate matters, it's a different thing. But I don't foresee a lot of everyone is expecting, everyone is saying. So we don't know. I can't see that. I don't know. You can say something, but I can't see any changes. What changes can there be? Except that nothing. I'm blank on that. I don't see any changes, very honestly.
Right, Anshul sir. It was great interaction. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Purush. Have a, be safe and enjoy your break.
Thank you, sir.